So really the thesis of the presentation is to give you intellectual infrastructure and basically intellectual programming that you can use to then to be able to move forward in your life and to be able to make decisions more decisively. And to know that the decisions that you make are going to be correct because you can't afford to make mistakes. They're extremely costly. They cost a lot personally, emotionally, and maybe even monetarily if you make the wrong decision. But if you make the right decision, then you're going to leverage your knowledge and you're going to move forward more in a stronger fashion, and you'll shorten the process and you'll be successful even faster than you imagine. But it's going to take you to understand what we're doing here, and if you can understand this and pull it together, then you will go far extremely fast. Okay? And I have no doubt that all of you will be extremely successful. So the first model, it's called the nomenclature of knowledge. It's basically a mathematical equation, harks back to the pretest, and it basically is a social science model that basically lays out a series of equations that need to be solved simultaneously. Now, the dependent variable is the value of equity. So if you can forecast the direction of the value of equity, then you can hedge, you can invest, and it becomes extremely important. And the value of the equity is not the value of the equity in your equity portfolio, but it's the equity of your own personal equity, your human capital, that you will accumulate over time, and then you will diffuse it to other people around you, and you will probably diffuse the monetary aspects associated with your human capital. So the question is, do you understand how the world actually works? Well, the world actually works in a social science model, okay? This is not a physical science model that has five variables. It's dictated by the laws of science. If I was to test gravity right now and drop these eyeglasses 100,000 times, it would drop to the floor every single time. That's not the case in social sciences. Social sciences are extremely complex science. Each of the individual equations in which you're trying to forecast the value of the equity has 50 variables in it. And there are variables in one equation that are in the other. So if there's a movement in one equation, it's going to move the outcome of the other equations. So it's extremely complex. I mean, there is basically 11 models here with 50 variables in it. So that's an 11 by 50 factorial, which you all know because you took your finite math. You know that's an extremely large combination of variables. So to be able to solve the value of the equity equation, you have to solve it simultaneously. And the way that you solve it simultaneously is that you are the only ones who can solve it simultaneously. The human brain is the most powerful supercomputer ever devised. You have basically the most powerful computer on your shoulders right now, and you probably don't even know it. You, every single day, when you talk to other people and you communicate, you transact over a trillion biological transactions in your brain every single day. And just your ability to be able to communicate through language and linguistics makes you extremely extraordinary, because a lot of other beings cannot even communicate through language. So you have a massive biological supercomputer on your head. This leveraged in combination with technology, your handheld computers, your laptops, your tablets, your access to the internet, your access to computers, totally leverages your intellectual capabilities and capacities beyond any other generation ever in history. So you are the most powerful generation in history. And the question will be for you is, what is your accountability and responsibility associated with the power, with that knowledge? What are you going to do with that power? And that's really going to be the question for you, because you will be powerful. You will be able to control other people. You will be controlling other people and their monies. You will have major influences on people around you. As a fiduciary in an accounting firm, a fiduciary as an investment advisor, as a principal within a corporation, you have a lot of power, and you already have it now. And the question is, do you recognize it or not? So the key is to this equation is that for you to understand that you have infinite storage capabilities for the data, and you have infinite processing capabilities within your brain. So you can massively store infinite amounts of data and then be able to process that data using the information and logic and the models that you've learned in all of these courses, in all of these disciplines within your education along with your experience, and know that at some point in time when you're confronted with a problem, that you can retrieve the data, process the information, and know that the decision that you're making is correct. And you need to be able to make those decisions decisively and know that you're not going to make a mistake and you're not going to waste time. Because if you make the mistake, it's extremely costly. So what makes this model actually work within the modern context? And I designed this in 1996. There was no cloud computing. Computing right now on the processing side and storage is up around 25 million times it was in 1996. So this solution and this mathematical model can actually be solved right now because we have big data and we have massive data processing capabilities never before. And people are modeling this right now. Where in 96, they couldn't. Now you have machine language that can monitor linguistics and language across the whole internet to be able to pull the information together to be able to do the forecasts. You have a culture that basically perpetuates knowledge and transference and diffusions of knowledge. You have communication enabled through telecommunication, high-speed telecommunications line, wireless. Now things can move across the globe in a blink of a second. You have technology enabling. And one of the things I find really interesting in the physical realm is how this all can actually work, because we live in an environment of relative peace. We are not in Aleppo, we're not in Iraq, we're not in Afghanistan, we're not in some of these countries that are conflicted by massive amounts of poverty and lack of technology, social services, war, social pathologies. We live in an environment that is conducive to knowledge for us to be able to enable this type of modeling to be done for ourselves. So the major takeaways from the model is it's basically a machine language. You are basically are embedded with machine language. This is the operating system. It basically tells you how the world works. You need to understand accounting, you need to understand finance, you need to understand economics and public administration, and political science, and law, and philosophy, and theology, because it all works together. You got to understand managerial and financial accounting and the ratios that roll up to be able to access the capital markets through the finance. You need to understand the economic environments, both monetary and fiscal policies that are going to affect the value of your equity. You have to understand the political scientific process and how policies are formulated either by you, Congress, or the executive branch that are then debated within the political sphere and then enacted into laws with intended and unintended outcomes. And you need to understand what those outcomes are going to be, because if you're in the path of the destruction, you better get out of the way or you better have contingency plans in place. If you don't move or don't advise your clients to move from the destructive aspects of these policies, then you violated your fiduciary responsibility for them, to them. The legal system, the philosophical system, the political system is Western civilization. It's based out of Europe. There was philosophers, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Immanuel Kant, John Stuart Mills, Adam Smith. Those were all the founders that basically wrote the framework for political, economic, institutional arrangement in which we exist today. And if you look at the way that our system is run in this country, it's basically modeled after theological systems that have been around for over 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years. So the structure is basically the same. It's just different. And if you understand this, then you can navigate through the world and make decisive decisions. So there are variables in one equation that are in the other. It's a multi-institutional model. Simultaneous equation solution, you have to solve the equation simultaneously to be able to solve the value of equity. It's multiple regression, it's big data. Now you can actually solve it. And it's biological processing with infinite storage and retrieval and data processing. You have it. You have all those tools. And now that you recognize it. The next model is organizational diagnostics, logistics, and navigation. You're going to be talking to people. And the first thing you got to ask yourself is, where does this person come from? Where do they work? What is their position? Where are they in the hierarchy, you know, of the organizational structure? What is their educational background? Where did they grow up? Do they have kids? Are they married? Where did they grow up? You got to know all those things to be able to have communications with them and be able to connect with them. You're probably going to enter the organizational structure down here within the virtual realm or the organic or the team-based level. You're not going to go straight up here. You're going to come down here. Then the question is, can you map out through the organizational structure based on the organization and the industry a path to upward mobility? And to be able to understand at some point in time, you're probably going to run into some glass ceilings or some ceilings that are going to create immobility. And then the question is, what do? Do you move laterally within the organization, or do you pop out and go to another corporation where you can arbitrage your human capital and continue to move up if that's what you want? So down here, again, this is organic virtual team level. Moving up, you're going to be talking to the manager. The managing director or executive vice president of the division or product line. You're going to have the COO, CEO, and the board of directors. Can you communicate across functional lines? Can you create across divisional lines or layers across the organization? Can you have conversations from this layer with the managers, the EVPs? Can you have conversations with the CFO, CEO, CIO within the organization and have conversations with the board of directors and to be able to have those conversations? You have to be multilingual in business language. You got to be able to talk across the disciplines and across the different layers of the organization. So the question is, do you understand where you are, and do you understand who you're talking to? So the goal is you have to do an organizational structural scan first. You should be thinking about that. You should understand the organizational design based on industry and with the competitive advantage and disadvantages of the firm. You have to determine your location within the company and the value that you add within that division. You have to constantly be asking yourself, what value am I bringing the organization, and can I articulate it going forward? You have to understand how to navigate to arbitrage your human capital, and how do you build it and accumulate it? Do you know how to build and accumulate human capital within the organization to then arbitrage it, either internally or externally? You need to be willing to move and execute. Do you understand that at some point in time you're dead in the water? You're within a myopic organizational structure that is totally misaligned with the marketplace. You're wasting your time. So you need to be able to identify the opportunities, when to move, and then to be able to execute. You need to be able to communicate vertically and horizontally across the organization, and you need to be ready to go at any time to take advantage of the opportunities that are presented to you. You can't hesitate. You gotta move. So how do you do it? The next step is you gotta have a plan. You can't just, you know, go through life without a plan. You gotta be planning. So you gotta design a strategic career and academic plan. And you have to have a 20, 30, and a 40-year plan. I know that sounds ridiculous, but it's not, because 20, 30, 40 years will be upon you before you know it. And if you haven't planned and you haven't executed, then you're going to be regretting something for the rest of your life and wishing you had done something that you never did. So you got to put together a plan. And here's basically the plan. Well, first you have to understand, before you can plan and move forward, is you got to figure out what your priorities are and what your sacrifices you're going to have to make to be what you want to be in the future, because you're going to have competition for your time and your attention and your resources. Could be your family, could be your friends, maybe you're dedicated to sports or music or your job or school or some other factors. Those are going to be eating into your time, and you're going to have to decide, am I going to sacrifice time with my family and friends? Or am I going to have to go do that exam or fly to New York or fly to London or fly to Hong Kong to basically advance my career, because that's where I want to be in the future, and hopefully they will understand. And in a lot of cases, they will not understand. You will have a vision of who you want to be in the future, and your family and your friends will not understand, because you can't communicate within a soundbite. In 2 minutes, you can't tell them what you want. You can't even tell them in 2 minutes or 20 minutes or 2 hours in most places. You have to have ongoing conversations with them to be able to convince them that you're on the right track. And sometimes you're going to be sabotaged by your friends and your family because they won't understand, or they'll be jealous, and they will impede and get in your way of your success. They will try to sabotage you or get in your way. And then it's going to be up to you to decide, well, if I'm going to be able to move forward, what do I do to get beyond them? Because they're going to get in your way. So you have a few ideas. You can tell them to get the frick out of the way, because I'm going to go forward anyway, and I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Or you can go around them and just, you know, placate them and tell them, yes, that's what I really want, you're correct, and then go do something else. Or you can just tell them what they want to hear. For example, I got 5 master's degrees, 2 undergrads, and a doctorate. Everybody was saying to me the whole freaking time, oh, Larry, you must like school. At some point, I just said, yeah, I like school. Okay, and then that way, I didn't have to deal with them anymore. How do you articulate to somebody at the age of 22 that you wanted to be a financial engineer and build complex financial products for banking institutions, brokerage houses, and pension fund advisors? You think anybody's going to even understand what you're talking about at 22, 25 years old when you have a vision? So I just told them, yeah, I like school. So the key here is to move forward, to get in the game. And I like to use a sports analogy. To get in the game, you got to have a bachelor's degree. And that could take between 4 and 7 years, depending on where you go to school and how you grew up and how much resources and money you had. It could take a while. But once you get the degree, then that basically gets you into the game, okay? And you're not even a player yet. You're just in the game. The goal is to be a player within the game. So once you get the bachelor's degree, then you're within a 3 to 5 year, maybe a 7 year apprentice program, where you're accumulating knowledge, experience, and taking down certifications and licenses. For the CPAs, you're going to be getting your CPA, you're doing your level 1 and 2, getting all your credits, and getting all your hours and getting the CPA designation, which is extremely valuable. For the finance people, you're getting your CFA levels, maybe all 3 levels. And then for the finance people, you're probably getting your insurance license, or maybe your real estate license. Maybe you're getting a 66, a 7 if you're into product development and project management. You're probably getting a PMP designation from the Project Management Institute, or maybe a business analyst certification from Microsoft or Salesforce or something like that. So once you get through there, this is a traditional model. You're basically setting yourself up. Hopefully what you want to be planning now is going to the Ivy League or the best school or the best program you can get into. And again, you're going to need the grades to be able to do that, and you got to be planning that right off the bat. Because 2 years in advance, before you do the applications, you got to take the GMAT exam, and you got to get into the upper 90th percentile. And if you're really smart, you may want to consider doing a law degree or a joint law degree MBA. But you got to get into the upper 90th percentile of the LSAT just to get into the top law school. But if you get in the upper 90th percentile in both the LSAT or the GRE or the GMAT, which are the entrance exams, that gets you into a lot of the best schools. And if you have a letter of recommendations, a good statement of purpose, and you got good references, and you get good exams and good GPA, you will get into the best schools. Once you get into the best schools, you're basically set, because the Ivy League recruits at the top. The top firms recruit at the Ivy League schools. Okay, so once you're in for life. So it's almost like an insurance policy that you'll never have to look for work again, because they recruit and they take care of their own within their alumni networks. So once you get into the program, it's not even a 2-year program, it's only 18 months, it's 4 semesters. You get the winter breaks off, and then you go into a summer internship. Once you get the summer internship, if you get into a good internship, probably at the end of the internship, they're gonna offer you a job. Then you negotiate basically a salary and a bonus and basically an educational reimbursement to either pay for what you've already paid for, the first $75,000 of your first year, and they will take out the second $75,000. So basically your MBA program is totally paid for by the employer if you can negotiate it. So it's not about the money, it's about getting in. And once you're in and getting through it, you're done, you're set. So once you get through, how do you pay for it? Everybody's like, oh, I can't afford $150,000. Well, within this 5 to 7 years, you're saving your money, you're looking at grants and scholarships. Maybe your parents are lucky enough to be able to fund some of your education. Again, the employer buyout bonus is totally negotiable. Corporation, if you're entrepreneurial, you set up your own corporation, if it generates enough revenue, you can deduct the MBA tuition pre-tax through your C corporation. So you can do it that way too. And then if there's any gap, then you just use bank financing. So it's not about the money, it's getting it. So once you get through the program, you're in an associate apprentice program. That's probably gonna last 3 to 5 years. And then there's an EVP, VP, or managing director that's gonna be above you. These people are extremely mobile. They wanna move up too. So usually if you do a good job, when they move out, you move up. So you move right into their slot as a managing director or EVP. Then if you're highly ambitious and you're willing to make the sacrifices, then you can move up into the CEO, COO, CFO, CIO, CTO, whatever it is, and you can spend another 10, 20 years up there. So you can see if you're like 25 years here and you add up all the math, it's basically a 30, 40 year program. And it happens like that. And you gotta be positioning and jockeying and be cognizant of the path that you're on, or else you're gonna make mistakes. So what's the economics around this? Well, you're 25 years old, in 20 years you'll be 45, in 30 you'll be 55, in 40 you'll be 65. Now here's the reality of the situation. If you make on average $100,000 a year, let's say that you're gonna go on, and over the next 20, 30, 40 years, you're gonna make on average $100,000 a year. That's not that much. But if you do, in 20 years to replace that income is $2 million. If you make $100,000 over the next 30 years, that's $3 million. 40 years, that's $4 million. If you have a working career of 40 years, which you probably do, based on health technology, your longevity is gonna be really long, you will probably live 40 years and have a 40-year career. It basically means that you currently, right now, sitting in the seat, these seats, you are worth at least $2 to $4 million. That's the reality. You are worth $2 to $4 million. Now here's the sad part about it, is most people your age do not have life insurance. They don't like it, they don't believe in it. It only costs you maybe $500 for $1 million to cover you for 20 years, so $1,000 for $2 million a year for 20 years, guaranteed. If something was to happen to you, your parents get nothing. Your family gets nothing. They've invested hundreds of thousands of dollars into you right now to get you where you are today. And if something happened to you, which I'm sad to say, something will probably happen to the students that I've educated over the last 20 years, in a lot of cases, they do not have life insurance and their parents will get nothing. So they invested all that time, all that money, all that effort to get you here, and yet they get nothing if something was to happen to you. And that's all you have to do, is spend $500 or $1,000 a year for 20 years, and if something happens to you, your parents and your family are taken care of. That's it. And the money will go to them tax-free. So you are worth a lot right now, and I don't know if you recognize that. So the takeaways here, 20 to 30 years goes fast. You need to plan and stay on track in your programs. Do not worry about the money. About the programs. Do not worry about the money and shoot for the best school and the best program. Do not let anybody get in your way. Go through them, go around them, but always know, always stay on track and go forward. Always be going forward. The next model is a social learning model. Okay, and this model I adapted from Albert Bandura from Stanford University. He will probably win the Nobel Prize in psychology within the next 10 years. He was a major innovator in social psychology, in social learning, and modeling, and self-efficacy. And Bandura's work basically stated that we all model other people around us, either we know it or we don't, either consciously or unconsciously. We model our parents, we model our uncles, we model our sisters, God help you, we model our friends. And we model their good and their bad behaviors. And there are consequences associated with those good and bad behaviors. So the question is, do you understand that you model other people's behaviors, either consciously or unconsciously? And if you do realize that you model other people's behavior, you are now in control of your psychology. Because now you understand that you are mimicking them in a lot of cases. The question then becomes, of the models that you're modeling, their attributes and their behavior, are they the attributes and the behavior that you want to model? That are behaviors and attributes that are going to get you to where you want to go and who you want to be at the end of the day. So I basically took some of Skinner's work, B.F. Skinner's work, and I took some of Maslow's work, and I kind of combined it together. So here you have your actual self. This is where you are right now, how you perceive yourself. And obviously where you perceive yourself right now is not where you want to be or what your ideal or your target self is in the future. I know you see some kind of animation of where you see yourself and who you see yourself as in the future. So there is a gap. There is a cognitive dissonance between your actual self and your ideal self, and particularly your target self. What is the target self? Well, the target self should be a series or a portfolio of models of people that you've identified around you that have attributes that you want to emulate and you want to mimic, because you've seen the rewards associated with their economic or their moral or ethical or professional behaviors. So you identify the models, you identify the attributes, you put together a target self, which becomes the ideal self, and you start to try to close the gap, the cognitive dissonant gap. And the way that you do it is you do it through the process of self-efficacy. Self-efficacy. And self-efficacy basically states that I am going to try to emulate these attributes and these models. I want to get in the upper 90th percentile of the GMAT. I see myself at a major law firm. I see myself as a marketing director in the future. How do I get there? I find other people who are successful, and I start to emulate their behaviors and start to emulate their paths. But the problem is you're not them. So when you try to get 90th percentile on the GMAT or try to mimic their behaviors, you're going to fail. And the question is do you see your failure as a genetic predisposition or a lack of information? If you think it's a genetic predisposition, then you're not going to really do anything about it because you failed already. But if you say, hey, I think it's just a lack of information, I have persistence, I have drive, I'm going to continue to emulate these behaviors and try to succeed at these things. And again, it's not genetic predisposition, it's just a lack of information. And what you'll find out is that through persistence and perseverance, you will gain the information and the knowledge that you need, and then you will get the 90th percentile on the GMAT. It's just through the process of trying. So I've identified basically two types of individuals. These are extreme individuals, but I hear this all the time when I work with people. I'm a scientist, I'm an analyst, I'm a mathematician, I really like math, I'm good at numbers, I'm kind of an introvert, I'm not really good with people, I really don't like management, I'm good at numbers, my math, my mom, my dad, you know, I was really good at math, they were good at math, I noticed how they became successful being in medical science or whatever it is. I have a genetic predisposition towards math and science. I'm going to continue to pursue my career in that direction because I've seen the rewards and I've seen the wealth associated with it. And I'm going to try to avoid the sales and the management because I'm not really good with people and I'm not an extrovert. And then I have people on the other side that say, hey, you know, I don't like math. I'm not good at math. I don't want anything to do with math. I'm really good with people. I'm really good as a salesperson. I can communicate with people. My father, my dad, my mom were good salespeople. I've seen them become successful. I'm going to pursue that because I have a genetic predisposition towards sales and management, and I'm going to move in that direction, and I'm not going to deal with the math and the science. The majority of MBA students at the top schools are engineers. They realize that they're very smart people, that they've been pushed into this realm, but they realize that they can't be successful unless they come over here and learn how to be good salespeople and good managers. You can't raise capital for your company if you can't communicate. If you're an introvert, it doesn't work. So the science and the math people will learn how to become good sales and managers and become a hybrid individual. That's the ideal scenario. The sales and management people will learn the scientific aspects, the mathematical aspects, become comfortable with the math and the science, and again, become the hybrid individual. These are the people in the top schools, in the top programs, in the top companies. They're good at both. They may have come into it one side or the other, but they realize they need to be good at both. They work on their weaknesses and they become good at both. It just takes time and perseverance, and you got to go through the self-efficacy process. So failure is not a genetic predisposition. It is a lack of information and persistence and perseverance. If you can do this and this so far, there are some extremely powerful outcomes associated with this, particularly from the psychological standpoint. Because if you can do this, the first thing you're going to get from the process is a persona. You will get a strong personality. You will have a presence when you enter the room, because you will communicate that competency and that presence and that personality through your dress and how you look. You will be able to communicate with extremely precise language to different people at different levels of the organization. You will know that the language that you're using is extremely precise in who you're talking to. So you'll be able to use the language and be able to communicate very clearly. And by doing that, you are going to take on charisma. And once you get charisma, you are going to be able to lead people, and people will follow you based on your charisma. Because you will then have the power to be able to persuade people to be able to follow you and to do things on your behalf, because you have the charisma. And the biggest benefit to the whole thing is then you will become a model for other individuals. And once you become a model for other individuals and you have the charisma and they start coming to you and asking you if they can come with you and asking you to do things for you and asking you to take them with you, you will then have ultimate power, because then you will be able to decide who you get to take with you and who you don't take with you. And that's going to be heartbreaking, because some people you're not going to be able to take and you're not going to want to take them with you. But you have the power to be able to take people and make them successful and make them give them what they need in their lives. It's extremely powerful when you reach that state. So how do you do it all? You got to be extremely organized. You got to be extremely organized. I get asked all the time, how do you do it? How did you do it? How do you do it? Because I'm extremely organized. When I was your age, I had basically a strategic plan totally laid out for 5 years, and I updated it every single year. I basically re-ranked my priorities by year so I could then move forward and know that I was accomplishing things that I needed to accomplish to get the skills that I needed, the credentials, to become the financial engineer and be hired by Schwab as the managing director. I had it all planned out. I knew exactly where I wanted to go, but you have to have the plan. And the plan is not set in stone. You're going to rank your priorities from high to low, and then over time, your priorities may change. You just change it, because you're eventually going to get there. You're eventually going to accomplish those things. You may need to put off grad school for another year. You may not get the promotion for another year. That's fine. You're going to get there anywhere. Anyway, you just got to be patient. You also need to put together a tactical plan that basically lays out the next 3 years. You break it up into 6 month or quarterly increments, and you get down into your goals and objectives, your actual tacticals that I need to do to be able to move forward so I can get to where I want to be. Again, if you don't have a plan, you're just shooting in the dark. You're going to make a mistake. And you're probably going to be manipulated by people because you're making decisions outside the planning framework. You need to have an operational plan, which basically lays out all of the months going out a year or two with milestone dates clearly identified of what you need to do on a certain date to be able to take the GMAT test and get in the upper 90th percentile. I need to be able to be writing letters months in advance to be accepted into one of the top law schools. You got to be thinking at least a year in advance and mark out the key milestone dates and then back in to the days and the time that you need to be able to accomplish those milestone dates. And then the important is your daily planning, your weekly planning chart. I have a planning chart over there. I mean, it's totally laid out. I'm booked. Rolling every 2 weeks, I'm totally booked. Total activity, I'm doing something basically every hour of the day. And I try to book it, so that I'm constantly producing, and trying to get towards where I want to go. And the world basically revolves around a certain time. Everything revolves around the same time, everywhere. You're open between 5 a.m. and 8 a.m. in the morning. It takes you an hour to get to work, and you get there at 9. You work until 12 o'clock, you get an hour in the afternoon for lunch. Everybody gets back to work at 1 and works till 5. And then from 5 to, basically, then you're going to go somewhere, takes an hour, and then you have 6 to 11 p.m. to be able to do it. So you know exactly what you, where your resources are. The question is, how do you allocate your resources? And then if you have milestone dates, you have to start blocking out the time beforehand to be able to reach your milestone dates. You can't be just ad hoc. You got to be totally planning the whole time. So that's how you become a highly effective individual, is being be totally planning the whole time. And my planning was totally done like this for 15 years. Okay? You just can't take down, you know, 8 master's degrees, 200 grads, and a doctorate, and then work full-time and teach full-time. Can't do it unless you're totally planning everything out. So you are going to be extremely successful. If you guys save, how much time do I have? Another half hour?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll be done with this early enough. You are going to be extremely successful. If you save $1,000 a month for the next 40 years, you will have $4.3 million in the bank if it compounds at an 8% annual rate for the next 40 years. $1,000 a month, 40 years, $4.3 million. At least that. Okay, but you got to do it. So what are you going to do with the money? And you're going to get money. You're going to make money. You're probably going to invest in the market. You're going to invest in real estate. You're going to invest in your family. So you're going to be investing in assets. And they're going to generate returns. And you're going to plow that money back. Now, the sad part about it is somebody's going to steal your money. Guaranteed. And they're going to try it. Either they're going to steal your money or they're going to steal your parents' money. And that's the biggest concern I have for you guys. Because I don't think you know where the money is. I don't think you know where the money is. I don't think you know your parents' situation. I don't think you know where the assets are. I don't think you know who's on the accounts, who's the beneficiaries. Do you have wills, trusts set up? You don't know where the money is. Is, you know, your brother, your father-in-law? Is it your uncle? Is it your sister that has basically moved in and signed in on your on the accounts and on the wills and the documents, that basically when something happens to your parents, it all goes to her or him or your or the partner or somebody else? And again, if it's not somebody else trying to steal your shit, the government's going to steal it. Guaranteed. They're going to steal it. So what do you do? How do you do it? Well, you got to put together an investment plan to be able to accumulate and be able to asset protect your assets. If you don't asset protect them, somebody's going to steal your stuff because you're exposed. So the first thing is you need some kind of tax strategy, some kind of tax arbitrage. When you go work for a company, they're probably going to have a 401k set up for you. They're either going to match it or they're not going to match it. So you're going to plow money into this 401k pre-tax dollars that's going to accumulate until you retire. But the problem is you can only accumulate so much within those pre-qualified accounts. Pre-tax accounts, you can only have between like $2 and $3 million in there, because what will happen is when you turn 70 and a half, the required minimum distributions are going to kick in. The federal government's going to show up on your doorstep and say, we want our money. Well, you overfunded your qualified accounts and now you make too much money and you're being pushed in the highest tax bracket in the alternative minimum tax. Nice job. I don't know who your advisor was. But a lot of people make those mistakes. You can put the money, you can roll the 401ks into self-directed IRAs, which I highly recommend. Do not leave your money with another company. Do not leave your money with a company. Roll it over into a self-directed IRA, get an advisor to help you oversee your money. Do not leave it with the company because they could go bankrupt and they'll still steal the pension obligations. You can also set up a SEP. If you're self-employed, you can put about $53,000 into that per year. It's pretty easy to set it up. And if you make a lot of money through your companies, you can set up a defined benefit program and plow up to $250,000 pre-tax into those accounts. So basically, you fund that defined benefit for 8 years, you're done. You're done on the qualified side. And I hate to say it is, once you're done with this side, you are forced into the after-tax realm, okay? You now have to pay your taxes, and now you have all this money that you need to deploy. Where are you going to put the money after tax? You can put it in stocks, bonds, you're probably going to invest in businesses, you're probably going to invest in real estate. I know I'm heavily involved in startups, So I have a lot of my wealth with startup companies on that side. If all of a sudden one of those startups goes public, all of a sudden I got all this money over here, and I'm done over here. So where am I going to put my money? What you do is you will sell off the assets over here because you're over-concentrated, and you will plow the money down below the line. This is aggressive pre-tax, aggressive after-tax, and since you're so young, you're going to put most of your money in businesses, stocks, and real estate. And then once the wealth effect occurs, you're going to sell off those assets to reduce the exposure, and you're going to invest in the safe side after-tax. Muni bonds, California muni bonds, federal and state tax-free. The largest muni bond market here in Northern California, any place in the United States, because of the wealth effects. Cash value life insurance, guaranteed and fixed annuities. You put money down into here, what happens is it kicks off a cash flow that will maintain and increase your standard of living, not only for you, but your family, for the rest of your life, and you will never run out of money. You will never run out of money. And that's the biggest problem, is running out of money. So you need to understand tax arbitrage and how do you accumulate wealth. The second is, during the accumulation phase, how do you accumulate? Where do you put your money? Well, the first place you need to put your money, as we just talked about, that you're worth $2 to $4 million, is you're going to put your money in a convertible term life insurance policy. That's the first thing you're going to do. Imagine $1,000 a year for 20 years, and you control a $2 million asset. Where in the capital markets can you control a $2 million asset for $1,000 a year for 20 years? Where in the capital markets? What investment allows you to basically control a $2 million asset for $1,000 a year, guaranteed level for 20 years? Nowhere. It's the most powerful vehicle ever invented 167 years ago. Fully adopted. And then you can convert it into a cash value life insurance or a variable universal life policy and create an investment vehicle out of it, where the premiums that you pay will accumulate tax-free, and when you borrow back on the cash values, you can pull it out tax-free. And if you pass away, in the death benefit from the term or the cash whole life policy or the variable universal life policy goes to your beneficiaries, if you're underneath the $5.3 million in estate tax ceiling, it will go to your beneficiaries tax-free. 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 Also, if you have kids and you don't think that your kids are going to take care of you in old age, because we're all going to get old, you may want to consider long-term care insurance. And if you have a C corporation, you can deduct the premiums. And you can put your wife or your husband on it too. So that when you do lose two abilities to function on a daily basis, the benefits of a long-term care policy will kick in. You can get between $200 and $400 per day in daily benefits. That will basically last up to 10 years while you're in the congregate care, and then you're on your own. And they're really expensive places to go. Over a 20-year period, it could cost between $2 and $4 billion and totally wipe out all of your wealth and your family's wealth in the process. Disability insurance. You're going to go work for companies. Maybe you're going to be a partner in an accounting firm or something. They're going to get disability insurance on you, and they're going to get life insurance on you too, because you're a key person within the organization. If something happens to you, they're going to want to get some money back to be able to use the money until they find somebody to replace you. Or you have such large human capital and intellectual property within the company that if you go, a major significant portion of the value of the corporation goes away too. Property casualty insurance, you're going to need if you're going to own real estate, both residential and commercial. Because if you underinsure it, your building's worth $3 million, but you only insured it for $2 million, and a fire comes through and an earthquake takes it out, you're going to have to come up with $1 million out of your pocket to replace the building and reconstruct it. And you're probably going to need a business umbrella insurance too, because if you own real estate assets, if you run businesses, you are going to be a target by creditors, and they're going to come after you. And you run a 12-unit apartment building, and you're the owner, and you hold it as a sole proprietor, and they trip and fall, and they sue you, or maybe somebody gets killed on your building, and they sue you, they can come after all your assets and take them. So you need to have the business umbrella insurance with the attorneys in place to be able to advocate on your behalf and protect you from unscrupulous individuals that are trying to steal your shit. So that's the risk management side. Then you have the investment management side. We talked about the qualified accounts. You're going to accumulate money in your 401k. You're going to roll it over into the self-directed IRA. They're probably going to be invested in stocks, bonds, you know, mutual funds. But if the market goes down, the value of your retirement account goes down too. So what people have done is they rolled over some of their IRA money into a variable annuity, invested in mutual funds with guaranteed investment protection riders on it, which basically is a 12-year put option. For 1 point of the value of your portfolio, you can buy a 12-year put option. So if you put $100,000 into this account and you buy the put option, if all of a sudden the market takes a tank and your value of your portfolio goes to 50 grand, the insurance company will compensate you the 50 grand and you'll still have 100 grand in the account. And over 3 years, over time, you lift the floors and you lock in your wealth strategically over time until you run out of options to put in place, and then it will run another 12 years. So you're basically locking in your wealth so that you don't lose the money and you don't run out of money. You can also roll over money into guaranteed future income annuities. I got $1 million in my retirement account. I'm 55 years old. I don't need the money until I'm 75, so that's 20 years. I give $1 million to the insurance company, and the insurance company says, hey, I'll tell you what I'll do. You give me $1 million today, and by the time you turn 75, I'll give you $100,000 a year for the rest of your life. Oh, and we'll do a joint account. I'll give you $100,000 a year for the rest of your life, and if you die, I'll give you the 100 grand to your wife for every year for the rest of her life. So you're guaranteeing and locking in the standard of living so that you don't run out of money. And these products were invented right after the financial crisis because people lost 70% of their wealth and couldn't retire. And some people are still hurting and still working because they never recovered. And if these products were in place, it would have protected their wealth. You can also use these products in the non-qualified side. At some point, you're done over here. You got to move over here into the after-tax realm. You can put money into a stock brokerage account where you're investing money in stocks and bonds and mutual funds. It's highly liquid. I want to put my money in this account. I want to earn a return, but I want to be able to liquidate those assets to be able to use for education and M5, maybe a down payment on a house, whatever it is. But you want your money to be working for you. And that's one you want to be either managing it yourself if you're good or having a professional person manage it. You can also invest in these variable annuities, into these mutual funds, with the guaranteed investment protection riders. And what's great about these, and people love them, is because you can plow as much money as you want to into those annuities. There's no limit to the amount that you can put in. As you put the money in, it's going to accumulate tax-free. And you're only getting it taxed when you pull the money out and you take it as income. And if you don't pull the money out and you don't ever use it, then there will be a beneficiary on the annuity contract and it will go to your heirs. And these annuity contracts asset protect, so if you get sued and somebody tries to steal your shit, they can't pierce the veil around the annuity and get at the assets or get at the income. So it's a way of protecting your assets. You can also invest in these guaranteed future income annuities. People love these too, because you're using after-tax dollars. And two-thirds of the income that you're taking when you start taking the income is tax-free. Because the IRS basically says that it's on a FIFO basis, and that a portion of the money that you're taking is a return on the premium that you put in. And then you can invest in real estate and businesses. So, and if you adhere to this is the snail approach or the tortoise approach to investing. The way I look at it is, I don't want to be a hare. I don't want to run out of gas right behind the goal line. I want to take it easy. I want to be smart. I want to be safe. I want to get across the goal line, and I want to reach my retirement and my investment objectives. So then I can be able to leave the money to my heirs. Okay, and how do you do that? Okay. Okay, so you're going to accumulate an X date in the future, and maybe your parents are approaching this stage right now, or definitely your grandparents are approaching this stage. And you'll see, once they reach 75, 85, definitely, they're going to start planning this stuff. And they better have this stuff in place, because if it's not in place, somebody's going to steal the shit. Okay. So you have assets. They're going to be assets that are going to be inside of a trust and outside of a trust. You cannot put inside of a trust certain investments such as partnerships in real estate and businesses. They can't go in the trust because there may be partnership agreements that basically state that you cannot put these proportional interests within a trust, so they sit outside the trust. Then you're going to hold assets, maybe wholly owned businesses or real estate, that you're going to want to put inside the trust, inside an irrevocable trust at X date. And you got to do it 3 years before you die. If you don't, then it's not going to work. So you have to plan the stuff, and you got to do the actuarial forecasts to figure out what your wealth is going to be and then what your estate taxes are going to be, and start figuring out how you're going to extinguish those estate taxes. Because if you die and leave those assets to your heirs, you're leaving them a tax liability. So you need to be able to do the planning. So here's how it works. You're going to have the fractional interests out here, okay? And they're probably going to be leveraged too. So not only are you looking at a tax liability, but you're looking at leverage. Okay, there may be mortgage on the assets or margin on the accounts. And if something happens and you pass away, usually your heirs are going to get a tax bill and they're going to get a debt bill. And a lot of times you're going to have to liquidate these illiquid assets to pay off the taxes and to pay off the mortgage or the leverage. And they're not going to have enough money to pay off the taxes and to pay off the leverage. So you basically left your heirs with a tax bill. Thanks, Dad. Nice planning. If you put the assets in an irrevocable trust, when you pass away, the assets will go to your heirs at a stepped-up basis. They will pay no income taxes and no estate taxes if they're underneath the estate tax ceiling. But you may have mortgage debt over here, or leverage, that you apply to these assets, which will come due when you die and if your heirs decide to sell the assets. So what do? You set up an irrevocable life insurance trust. You predict and figure out what the mortgage debt is going to be, or the margin debt. You figure out what the tax liabilities are going to be in the future, and you get a life insurance policy, and you make the trust the beneficiary of the policy, so that when you pass away, the trust gets the death benefit, and the death benefit extinguishes the mortgage, the taxes, the margin, everything. And all of the assets go to your heirs, go to you, estate, gift, tax-free, mortgage, debt-free. Thanks, Mom. Thanks, Dad. Thanks, Grandpa, for being on top of it and doing all the planning. But again, you're going to have to make sure that a lot of this stuff is set up. You're going to have to make sure that these accounts are set up correctly. If somebody hasn't snuck in here and basically modified the trust accounts, modified the beneficiaries on the accounts, so that, because you may get nothing. And if it's not set up right, you're looking at a huge government tax liability, and you'll probably get pennies on the dollars from the total wealth that your grandparents and parents have accumulated, and maybe yourself, over decades and generations. They made a mistake because they didn't believe in it. I hear that all the time. I don't believe in the stock market. I don't believe in trusts. I don't believe in insurance. I don't believe in you. I hear it all the time. And then when something happens, they come back to me. They call me up. I remember you were telling me about something. Can I still do that? Well, what happened? Oh, sorry, you were supposed to do that when I recommended you doing that 3 to 5 years ago. If you would have done it, it wouldn't have been a problem. Now you're in trouble, and now you got to get attorneys and accountants to figure it out. But you probably lost $5 million in the process. But the key is to avoid the taxes. Now, I don't know about you, but I love taxes. I swear to God, I'm like one of I just love taxes. I love income taxes. You know, if you make a lot of money, you can be taxed 39 to 70% based on alternative minimum. Love it. and then you couple in the state, federal, local, awesome. I love taxes. Capital gains, 20%. Obamacare, 10%. Love Obamacare. Transfer taxes on your real estate, cute little 10% tax that you can get. I love this cute little transfer tax. And then you got retail sales taxes, right? State and local could add up to 10, 12%. I love taxes. I love it. But you got to avoid the taxes because they're going to come after you. You got to have a really good tax plan. You got to have a good tax plan. You got to have a good attorney. Attorney, and you got to have a good accountant. And then lastly, on the planning side, your parents got to have at least a will. Still going to go through probate. The government's still going to screw with your assets. You got to have a will. You got to have a medical directive because if something happens to them and they become impaired, my dad was taking down $750 million in intensive care every 6 months. He died with over $1 million in medical expenses. Luckily, we had the medical, insurance, but we didn't have the medical directive. And if he would have continued to live, he wouldn't have come back, and the medical directive would have kicked in. It would have cost us all our wealth, our whole family. The living trust, you got to have at least a living trust that basically states where the assets will go to circumvent probate. Irrevocable trusts, we talked about them. To be able to asset protect and circumvent, get the stepped up basis and be able to circumvent the estate and the income taxes. There are also dynasty and generational skipping trusts. Now this is a great one. These are great. Because this is when your parents say, we love you. We know you're going to be extremely successful. You don't need our money. So we're going to give them to your grandkids, okay? So they're going to just cut you out of the deal and give it to the grandkids. You got charitable remainder trusts. You throw the real estate asset in a charitable remainder trust. The asset's worth $5 million. You can pull out $5 million out of the charitable remainder on a tax-efficient basis. And then when you pass away, the asset goes to the charity. And then there are intentionally defective and other types of trust structures that can be customized to asset protect and to circumvent taxes for people. So it's a whole nother area. Whew. So that's basically it.